us. Would that be agreed upon or not? لا. فقال كذبت. He said you lied. لكنك أتعلمت ليقال هو عالم. Rather you learned so it could be said that he is a scholar. فقد قيل. And it was said. وقرأت القرآن ليقال هو القارئ. And you read the Quran so it can be said he is a reciter. فقد قيل. And it was said. ثم أمر به فيصحب على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار. So it likewise it will be ordered and he will be seized until he's thrown it on his face into the fire. The Shaykh says, وهذا مما يوجب للطالب العلم. He said, and this is from that which is necessary for the student of knowledge. And يخلص نيته لله عز وجل لطالب العلم is that he must rectify and purify his niyyah for Allah Azza wa Jal in his seeking of knowledge. And we touched upon this earlier about individuals who study because they want to just get a degree, or they study because they just want to land a job and the likes of this nature. When it comes to the deen of Al-Islam, we study for Allah Ta'ala. We study for Allah Ta'ala. And it's going to come, Ya'ani. The explanation, I'm pretty sure maybe it's a question, the Shaykh is going to answer it. So just hold on for a minute, inshallah. He says, فلا يكون قصده الترافع. He said that his intention is not studying so that he can be what? He can reach some high status, some high plateau. Now, so people look up to him. It's not why he's studying. It's not why he's learning ilm. He's learning ilm for a long time. And he's not studying. The Shaykh, he says, oh, لوظيفة الدنوية. And he's not studying for what? To get some job in the dunya. You see, Shaykh is very specific now. In case people, Yani, don't get it, he's very specific. We don't study before, Yani, this person want to get a high status. People look up to him. We don't study for a person want to get a job. No. The Shaykh, he says, وَلَا تَحْسِينَ الْحُطَامِ لِعِلْمِهِ وَتَعْلِيمِهِ. Notice he studies so that he can receive the vanities of this worldly life by his knowledge and for his teaching. It's not why he studies. Why does a person study? Why does a person learn? The Shaykh, he says, وَإِنَّمَا يَكُونُ قَصْدُ لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. But rather he studies only for Allah عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. لِأَنَّ تَعَلُّمُ الْعِلْمِ وَتَعْلِيمَهِ مِنْ أَجَّلِّ الْأَعْمَالِ الصَّالِحَةِ. That learning knowledge and teaching it are from the best righteous actions. Are from the best righteous actions. And this sentence is very, I want you to contemplate this sentence because just like learning the ilm and teaching the ilm is from the best of the righteous actions. Understand that if your knee is not correct, then it will be from the worst things for you. If your knee is correct, now it's from the best righteous actions. If not, then it's from the worst things you can ever do to yourself. Because the end result of this individual is what? He'll be thrown on his face into the fire. Now, so one time one of the people once said to me, One of the Tulab al-Ilm giving some advice, he said, if you can purify your niyyah, then there's nothing comparable to seeking knowledge. If you can purify your intention, there's nothing comparable to seeking knowledge. He said, but if you feel you have problems, and you're going to want to show off for X, X, Y, Z, then it's better for you to be an engineer who fears Allah and reads the Quran. This is his advice. And I'm like, this is Allah khaira. Because he intended well. But I don't necessarily agree 100% with it. Looking back now, retrospect, I don't necessarily agree 100%. Because I don't want you to think the option is, okay, if I think I'm going to show up, then guess what? I ain't going to learn. I'm going to be ignorant. I'm going to remain ignorant. Nah. I don't see that as an option. Because the Prophet, ﷺ, he said, that seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every Muslim. So there's something from seeking of knowledge that we all have to do, in regards. So when it comes to belief in Allah Ta'ala, we have to all believe in Allah Ta'ala correctly, and that's based upon ilm. We can't say, I must lie, because I don't know, I mean, you know, I may want to show off and stuff, show people I know that, shuruq la ilaha, la, show people I know, yeah, I mean, how to probably believe in the angels, that's, I'm not going to learn it. La, it's not an option, you're not going to learn it. You have to learn it anyway. Fariḍah is wajib upon you. You have to learn it. You can't worship Allah Ta'ala based on jahil, based on ignorance. You gotta learn it. Na'am. طيب. Likewise, our belief in the messengers, and the angels, and the last day, al-qadr. All this necessitates from your knowledge. The proper methodology. What is our minhaj? Necessitates from your knowledge. Na'am. How can we not sit with Ahlul Bid'ah? Necessitates from your knowledge. There's a reason. We have to know why. Na'am. Why we don't listen to Ahlul Bid'ah? There's a reason. You need to know why. You need to know how do we deal with the Mu'tadi? How do we deal with the Bid'ah? Do we accept it? Are we tolerant? Or what? There's a methodology. It's not a methodology. How do we call to Allah Ta'ala? There's a methodology that's been taught to us by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so we must know it and tread upon it. Because the minhaj and the aqidah, mutalazimatani, they go together. They will not be separated. They go together. Sheikh Rabi'i, he says that the aqidah and the minhaj, mutalazimatani, kashahadatan, or kashahadatain. That the minhaj, or the aqidah and the minhaj, they go together. They are stuck together, just like the shahadatain. He said, so can one come with La ilaha illallah and not Muhammad Rasulullah? Can one come with Muhammad Rasulullah and not La ilaha illallah? No, they have to be together. Likewise, the aqidah has to be together, but this is based upon what? Ilm. Likewise, the understanding, the meaning of Muhammad Rasulullah, ilm, based on ilm, so you have to learn. Ala kullin. So I don't accept, if you can't purify your niyyah, then just, you know, become a doctor and read the Quran and like that. La. Rather, purify your niyyah and seek the ilm. You see? Purify your niyyah and seek the ilm. Fight against yourself and seek that knowledge. That's the only way. Now, and if a person were to do this, then he would gain a tremendous benefit. So by seeking of knowledge and doing the righteous actions, the Shaykh says, and not intending by that some worldly gain, but rather, وَإِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ بِهِ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ, but rather he only intends by the face of Allah Ta'ala, only. Now, this is what the question may have been. But what about if you do something and then someone gives you money? What if you do something, you learn some knowledge, and then someone says, I want you to be the imam. Na'am? Would that conflict with your niyyah by being the imam? The Shaykh says, وَمَا يُعْتَى لَهُ وَيُعْطَى لَهُ مِنْ مَالٍ إِنْ أُعْطِي. Na'am? فَهُوَ تَابِعٌ وَلَيْسَ مَقْصُودٌ. Very important. He said, so if you're given something from money or the like, then that came after. That wasn't your intention. Why? Because your intention was what? To do it for Allah Ta'ala. You study for Allah Ta'ala. Damn. And then now someone wants to secure your time, so you have time to devote yourself to teaching the people Quran and teaching the people ahadith and the like, reading the salawat and the like, requires time. And obviously a person with 9 to 5 is not going to be able to do that job. Because it's going to necessitate that he be there from somewhere else from 9 to 5, obviously. Now, so to secure that, I say, well, we need you here from 9 to 5, or for longer, actually. They've been going to give you some money, so you don't have to worry about going there, because we need you here. So Shaykh, he says, if your intention was for Allah Ta'ala, that's why you studied, and then this opportunity arises afterwards, then no problem, because this came later. This is not what you did it for. You didn't do this with that in mind. Meaning that, for the talib al-ilm, if he becomes the imam, or doesn't become the imam, it's the same for him. If he works in the factory all day and teaches in his spare time, or if he's given a salary and he teaches all day, it's the same for him. Doesn't matter, because he didn't learn for that. He learned for Allah. So whether he gets his check from the master, or he gets his check from the factory, it really doesn't matter to him. It's the same for him, because he learned his ilm for Allah. This is the difference. This is the difference. Now, the third individual, رَجُلْ أَسَاهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى, man, is the person that Allah Ta'ala, he gave money. Now, so the Prophet ﷺ, he says, وَرَجُلٌ وَسَعَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَأَعْطَاهُ مِنْ أَصْنَافِ الْمَالِ كُلِّهِ, is a person who Allah Ta'ala, He enriched and he gave him from every different type of money. نعم. فأوتي به. So he will be brought. فعرفه نعمه فعرفها. And he will be made to acknowledge his blessings. And he will acknowledge them. فقال ما عملت فيها. And he will be asked, what did you do with it? فقال ما تركت من سبيل. He will say, يعني ما تركت في سبيل تحب أن ينفق فيه فيها إلا أنفقت فيها لك. He said that there was not a single thing that you love spending in except I spent in that way. So he said to him, كذبت. You lied. لكنك فعلت ذلك ليقال هو جواد فقطي. He said, rather, you did all of that just so it could be said that this one is generous, and it was said, ثم أمروا به فيسحبوا على وجهه حتى ألقي في النار. Then he will be brought and seized and thrown on his face into the fire. The Shaykh, he says, فإذا كانت هذه الأعمال الجليلة تذهب هدرا وتضيع على صاحبها يوم القيامة نظرا لنيات أصحابها وسوء قصدهم فغيرها من الأعمال من باب أولى. The Shaykh says, so since these great and tremendous and noble and praiseworthy actions of fighting and dying in the way of Allah Ta'ala, teaching, learning and teaching the Quran and spending in the way of Allah Ta'ala, now they totally were lost and were to no avail for the occupant Yawm al-Qiyamah. And this is because his intention was looked to. His intention it was looked to. The Shaykh, he says, so therefore we understand that other actions take precedence. And other actions take precedence. Like what? Like the pillars of Islam take precedence. These are the arkan of Islam, the pillars of Islam. So, from the salah, the prayer, and the zakat, the charity, the siyam, the fasting, the hajj, pilgrimage, the house, and the like, then these take precedence that they were done so sincerely and solely for Allah Ta'ala alone. So this was just an example. This was just an example. And the Shaykh says, يعني من صلاة وصيام وحج وعمرة وصدقة وطلبة العلم وتعليم وعمل بالمعروف ونهي عن المنكر ودعوة إلى الله تعالى نعم وغير ذلك. The Shaykh says, like the prayer, like the fasting, like the hajj, like the umrah, like the sadaqah, like seeking of knowledge and teaching, like ordering the good and prohibiting the evil, like calling to Allah Ta'ala, and other than that, take precedence. نعم فينبغي أن يراقب نيته. So it's important that a person, يعني, he inspects his intention. نعم ويتذكر نيته يعني بكل عمل يعمله. And that he looks to his action and every action that he does be أن يخلصه لله عز وجل. So that he cleans his niyyah and he makes it sincerely and solely for Allah Ta'ala. نعم. And an individual, he will have to do what? يطرد عن نفسه الرياء. He will have to repel from himself showing off. نعم. So I don't want anyone to think that showing off will just be simple, or the not showing off will just be a level that a person will reach, and that will even come across his mind. Now, the individual, he will have to intentionally repel showing off. Now, and not fall into the tricks of the shaitan. Because the ulama, they explain, because the shaitan, remember now, he was created before our father, Adam, alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, so the shaitan, he knows human beings very, very well. And he knows the different ways to trick the human beings. So if he come at you right and you block, he know how to come at you from the left and get you. If he come at you high and you block, he know how to come at you low and get you. So he always got a trick for everybody. So from the trick of Shaitan, a person, he'll come and he'll say, I want to pray, you know, some salatu to tawwur. I just want to pray two raka'ahs to tawwur. Now, for Allah Ta'ala. and he's in the masjid. Shaitan will come and say, he's just showing off. Maybe, you know, you don't want to make riyah. So maybe you shouldn't do that. Now, if a person listens to this whisper, and he doesn't do it, then this is wrong. This is wrong. Because the ulama say, when the shaitan approaches you like this, you're stuck between two evils. Because the shaitan has convinced you that you're going to do an action for the creation, so therefore, leave off the action for the creation. So either way, God, you're doing something for the creation. So the ulama say, the only way out to escape this is to do what? Is to repel that feeling of showing off, purify your intention, and pray for Allah Ta'ala. That's the only way out. It's not to leave off the action for the creation, not. Because then you fell right into the same trap. He didn't get you from the left, he got you from the right. He fell off the same trap, but you fell into the same trap. So ala kulli hal, the only way out is to do what? Purify your intentions and pray the salah. So you have to constantly be finding yourself. And this is why we mentioned the statement of one of the salaf where he said, يعني ما علاج شيء يسد علي بنيتي, that there was never the rectifying or the treatment of anything that was more severe upon me than my intention. That from all the things that I gave myself treatment for and so on and so forth, treating my intention was the most severe thing upon me. Because this is something that is going to be there. It's going to be there. As long as you're here, you're going to have to be struggling to purify your intention. Now, and Sheikh Fawzan, he says, why is this? Why we got to struggle to purify our intention? Sheikh, he says, لأن الإنسان بشر. Because, after all, we're just human. The individual, he's just a human being. Naam? Because he's a human being. Naam? يعلم له الرياء. He will be proposition with showing off. وحب المدح وحب الثناء. The individual, the human beings, and human beings almost by their nature, they like to be praised, they like to be given compliments, and so on and so forth. Now, فعليه أن يطرى هذا القصد إذا طرى عليه. So it's important that he repels this intention, or this evil intention of showing off in the light, when he's approached with it, or when it comes about upon him. نعم ويخلص نيته لله عز وجل. And he purifies his intention for Allah عز وجل. وقال الشاعر, and the poet, he said, يهوى ثناء مبرز ومقصر حب الثناء طبيعة الإنسان. He says that the desire and the longing for praise is felt by everyone who is accomplished and even those who are less than accomplished. Because the love for being praised is something which is natural to human beings. The love to being praised is something which is natural to human beings. So therefore, for the insan al-bashar, the shaykh says, so the person is a human being. So therefore he has to repel this evil intention. He has to repel this evil intention, min al-hubb al-madhi wa hubb al-thana, from loving of being praised and loving of the people speaking good and complimenting him. Naam? He must repel this. And likewise, an individual, as Imam al-Sa'di, he mentions in his tafsir, he must repel and make sure that his actions do not become habitual. That his actions do not become habitual. Because any action that is done habitually, likewise, will not be rewarded for. So for example, an individual may be used and accustomed to praying such a fajr. The alarm clock goes off, he pops up, he goes, he makes the wudu, he gets in his car, he comes to the masjid out of habit. That individual who does this out of habit will not be rewarded. Because innama al-a'malu binniyat, and if you didn't do it because that's your habit, you're not going to be rewarded for it. You have to do it what? تقرباً. You have to do it seeking to gain closest to Allah Ta'ala by way of it. Seeking the wedge of Allah Ta'ala. Seeking Allah Ta'ala's face. This is why you do it. For Allah Ta'ala alone, not because it's your habit every day. At dhuhr time, you pray dhuhr. Naam? La. Not just it's your habit before you go into the bath, you make the dua. And when you come out of the bath, you make the dua. Because that's your habit. La. You have to do this consciously. For Allah Ta'ala. So this is very important. Because from those who Allah Ta'ala blesses to be safe from doing things that show off or so that it can be heard and spoken about by others, or doing things for worldly gains and benefits and the like, the shaytan a lot of times attacks him with this, where he makes their worship habitual. Where a person, he does things out of routine. Out of routine, out of routine, out of routine. And many of you, and many of us, me myself included, because it is, they're closer to me than it is to you. Now, myself first and foremost, we have to check ourselves. And one of the ways of checking yourselves is next time you're praying and you're in the salah, and you catch yourself just words falling off your tongue, and you don't even understand, you don't even know what you're talking about. Although you may have known out of it. Words flying off your tongue, and you have to deny yourself. And you didn't even realize what you're saying. Then you have to check yourself. Is this habitual? Because now, words are just flying off my tongue. I'm not even thinking about what I'm saying. I'm just going through the motions. Now, anytime the salah is over, now, say for example, you pray by yourself, for example, sunnahs or the night prayer, whatever. You're at your work and you pray, God, now, in your cubicle, whatever. After that salah, ask yourself, what did you recite? If you can't remember, maybe your actions are habitual. And we all know ourselves. You pray a prayer, and you sit there, and then you say to yourself 5 minutes later, what did I recite? And it's like that I got. Don't even know. Why? Because you got these 4 or 5 or these 2 or 3 surahs that automatic roll of dice, you're going to pick for one. Right? What happened? What I mean? That's it. Because you say that every salah. You pray by yourself. If not that, what else? Or whatever surah you may habitually say, but that just becomes your habit. After that, boom, straight into it. Now, not even thinking. So much so that if someone asks you, hey, what did you recite in the second rakah? I don't know. One of these three, though. I know it's one of these three. That's what I would say. Now, but then you have to worry. Maybe your actions are habitual. They're habitual, then you're not getting a word for that. So you have to be very mindful of these things. Now, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he goes on and he explains he gives an example. Now, in this hadith, he gives us an example. And that example is the hijrah. Because he says that إِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى, that an individual he will have when he intended. فَمَا كَانَ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. So whatever his migration, his hijrah, was to Allah and His Messenger, then his hijrah will be to Allah and His Messenger. Na'am. And we understand what the hijrah is. That is, we leave the land of kufr to the land of al-Islam, fleeing with our religion. This is the asl of the hijrah. Now, leaving the land, this was intended. Leaving the land of the kuffar to the land of the Muslims. This is the asl of the hijrah. And we know that the reality of the hijrah, like the ulama explained, Shaykh Islam Ibn Qayyim and other than them, is that we leave off that which is haram, the asl. We leave off that which is haram to the obedience of Allah Ta'ala. Now, and the ultimate manifestation of that physically that you can do is to leave the land of disbelief to the lands of the Muslims. Yeah? And the hijrah, it is lasting until Yawm al-Qiyamah. You understand that the hijrah is lasting until Yawm al-Qiyamah. Yeah? And then the Shaykh, he explains that which is intended by the Prophet ﷺ's statement. If someone comes and say, no, there's no more hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ may say, la hijrah ba'da al-Fath, that there is no hijrah after the opening of Mecca, the conquering of Mecca. The Shaykh, he says that this is what is meant, that there is no hijrah from Mecca. So after Mecca became the land of the Muslims, a person can't move from Mecca to Medina and say, I'm going to get the word of a Muhajir. Nah. It's over. Because you're going from the land of the Muslims to the land of the Muslims. So you don't get that same reward. Nah. So the Shaykh, he explained that this is what it is intended by that. So the Shaykh, he goes on and he says, فَمَا كَانَ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. And this is the first type, the Shaykh, he says, وَهَذَا هُوَ الْقِسْمُ الْأَوَّلِ. This is the first type. He says, so whoever his hijrah is to Allah, when he says, "Over man can hijrah toward Allah," wherever his migration is to Allah, he says, "وَهُوَ الَّذِي أَخْلَصَ نِيَّتُهُ لِلَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فِي هِجْرَةٍ." Now, this is the one who purified his niyyah to Allah Taala with regards to the hijrah. So he made the hijrah for Allah Taala. Then the hijrah will be accepted from Allah Taala, and he will be rewarded for that hijrah, and he will be written as a muhajir. He'll be written as one who made hijrah. Now, and the opposite. The one who did not purify his niyyah, as it'll come, yani, but who's not purified niyyah, then he won't get that reward. The second part is as he began to go into, because the first part is that you make his hijrah for Allah, then he'll be rewarded by Allah. But if you make his hijrah for other than Allah Ta'ala, then what? He won't get any reward for that. And he will not be written as one who was a muhajir. Naam. So the one who made his hijrah to Allah Ta'ala's messenger, he'd be rewarded for that. And the one who made his hijrah for something else, for other than Allah Ta'ala's messenger, he won't be rewarded for that at all. Naam. فَمَنْ كَانَ هِجْرَةُ صُلَى اللَّهِ رَسُولِهِ هِجْرَةُ اللَّهِ رَسُولِهِ Whoever is hijrah to Allah's messenger, hijrah to Allah's messenger. وَمَنْ كَانَ هِجْرَةُهُ See, the Prophet ﷺ doesn't just leave it like that. Huh? He explains it in great detail. And he gives you an example. See, more examples. So it brings it close to your mind what's going on. So the Prophet ﷺ, he says, فَمَنْ كَانَ هِجْرَةُهُ لِلدُّنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا So whoever his hijrah is to the world to get it. The Shaykh Saleh Fawzan, he says, meaning that a person makes hijrah from the land of the kuffar and he goes to the land of the Muslims. Not for Allah's messenger, because the way of life there is better. Because, hey, I went online and I saw the current exchange rate and the dollar is so strong compared to that currency, I'm going to go there and live like a king. You see? Maybe a person, he gets his pension and he says, hey, my pension, I can't survive in this state. It's not enough. Right? Too expensive. Cost of living is too much, not enough. But with that pension, I go to Egypt and the exchange rate is like this and it's like that. I can live real good. So he makes hijrah for that reason. For some luxury. For some comfort. And the like. Then, as the shaykh, he says, فَهَذَا لَا يُكْتَبْ مَعَ مُحَاجِنِينَ This one, he is not written down with those who made hijrah. His reward is what? He lived like a king. That's it. That's all he's going to get. Nothing else. He's not written like he made the hijrah. He's going to get the reward of the muhajir. Now, or another example the Prophet ﷺ gave it to make it extremely, extremely clear. For the one who made hijrah to, yani for his, for the dunya then, or to gain some, yani benefit from the, some worldly benefit, or umra'atan yankihuha, or someone who made hijrah for a woman to marry her. Now, how many of the sisters who marriages, yani, propose to them, and they say, well, I'm not going to live in the land of the kuffar, so if you want to marry me, you got to come here. Huh? And the brother gets inside, hey, I'm out, I'm going, got the plan, you know, the family going to help me, X, Y, Z, so I'm going to get married. If that's your intention for going over there to get married to her, then you're not written as one who made hijrah. La. Even though you physically love the land of the kuffar, and you went to the land of the Muslims, if you went there just so you can solidify your marriage, then you don't get the reward as a person who made hijrah. Your reward would just be whatever you get from that woman. That's your reward. But you won't be written as one who made the hijrah. Because an individual, he has to do these actions for Allah, and Allah Ta'ala alone. And the last point that the Shaykh he really wants to bring home is some doubt that the individuals they bring. And that is with regards to articulating with the niyyah. Articulating the niyyah. The Shaykh he says, فَلَا يَجُوزْ أَتَلَفُّهُ بِالنِّيَّةِ He said, it's not permissible to articulate the intention. لَا عِنْدَ الصَّلَاةِ وَلَا عِنْدَ الزَّكَاةِ وَلَا عِنْدَ أَيِّ عَمَلٍ يَعْمَلُ He said, not when you're about to pray, not when you're about to give charity, and not when any action you're going to do. You never articulate your niyyah. نعم. He says, لِأَنَّ اللَّهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي قَلْبِهِ Because Allah Ta'ala knows what's in a person's heart. وَلَا يُفِيدُ هَذَا اللَّهُ So therefore, yeah, he's not benefited by this love, by you articulating it. Allah Ta'ala knows in your heart. So what's the use of you saying it? Now, there's no benefit in you saying it. And the shaykh, he says, حَتَّى لَوْ قَالَ Even if a person says, إِنَّهُ يَنْوِي وَجْهَ اللَّهِ He says, even if a person says, I intend by his mouth, he's articulating, I intend the praise of Allah. The Shaykh, he says, well, what is a Kadhalik? In his heart, he's not like that. He says, so Allah Ta'ala, he knows what's inside this person's heart. So articulating it, there's no need to articulate it. But rather, those who articulate it, then this is what? This is bid'ah. Articulation of it is bid'ah. Naam. And then there's some doubt which the people bring on Imam al-Shafi'i. And they said that Imam al-Shafi'i, and he used to say that you can articulate your niyyah. That you can articulate your intention. There's a doubt that they bring on Imam al-Shafi'i. The Shaykh asked this from both sides. He said, firstly, هَذَا لَمْ يَصِحَ الْإِمَامُ الشَّافِعِي. He said, firstly, this is not even authentic on Imam al-Shafi'i. This is not confirmed that Imam al-Shafi'i even said this, firstly. He said, secondly, even if it was affirmed on Imam al-Shafi'i, bam, he said, فَلَيْسَ حُجَّةً. He said, it's not a proof. Even if Imam al-Shafi'i said it, not a proof. So firstly, it's not confirmed on Imam al-Shafi'i. And secondly, even if it was confirmed on Imam al-Shafi'i, it's not a proof. It's not a proof. Naam. He said, because Imam al-Shafi'i, he was a mujtahid. Yukhti wa yusib. He was one who was a mujtahid. He made mistakes and sometimes he was correct. Naam. The Shaykh, he says, وَالْحُجَّةِ فِي كَلَامِ الرَّسُولِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The proof is what? Is in the statement of the Messenger صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Naam. The proof is in where? It's in the Qur'an. He said, the proof is not in the Kalam al-Shafi'i, وَلَا أَحْمَدْ وَلَا أَبِي حَنِيفَ وَلَا مَالِكْ إِلَىٰ أَرْضٍ. It's not, the proof is not in the statement of Abu Hanifa or Imam al-Shafi'i or Imam Ahmad or Imam Malik and the like. Brother Shaykh al-Thaymeen, rahimahullah ta'ala, used to say that the ulama, their statements require proofs and they're not proofs. He said the ulama, their statements are not proofs, but in fact they are in need of proof before they can be substantiated. Naam, this is the haq. So Muhammad Naya, whoever the person is, if he says something and it contradicts the Book of Allah, it contradicts the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it's something that none of the Sahaba knew about nor knew anything about, and this was not from their way, it's not to be given any consideration. Thirdly, he says, that which has been narrated on Imam al-Shafi'i, that which has been authentically narrated on Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, as-salat, that the prayer, laysa kaghayriha, that the prayer is not like other than it, as-salatu la yudkhalu fiha illa bidhikrillah, that the prayer is not entered except by the remembrance of Allah. The Shaykh, he says, this doesn't mean the niyyah. He doesn't intend by this that you articulate, I'm about to pray Salatul Dhuhr, four raka'at. He said, this is not what Imam al-Shafi'i meant. He said, but rather Imam al-Shafi'i meant by that statement, by the statement, yani bil-dhikr, ay takbir, Allahu Akbar. That's what Imam al-Shafi'i meant. He didn't mean that you articulate your niyyah, but he meant that the salah is started by the dhikr, Allahu Akbar. Naam, takbir. That's what it started by, not by no dhikr. And then the Shaykh, he also brings about or dismisses the doubt. Because some may say, well, what about the talafud yani عند الذبح? What about talafud yani بنيه yani عند الذبح? What about when you articulate your niyyah before the slaughtering? Naam? As it's been authentically reported. As the Prophet ﷺ said, أُمَّ مِنْكَ وَلَكَ عَنْ مُحَمَّدٍ وَأُمَّتِهِ بِإِسْمِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ ثُمَّ ذَبَحَ. Naam? That, oh Allah, this thing we're going to kill, yani is provided by you and for you, done by Muhammad and his nation in your name, or in the name of Allah Ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, and then he will kill the animal. So some people say that this right here is a proof that you can articulate your niyyah in this instance. And the Shaykh, he says, even though some of the people of the Fuqaha say this, this is still not correct. He said, rather what is correct is that this here, he said, هذا الدعاء وليس تلفظ بالنية. He said, this is just a dua that is said before you slaughter, and it's not articulating your intention. It's a dua, it's not you articulating your intention, so this too is not a proof for the articulation of the niyyah. فنكتفي إن شاء الله تعالى بهذا القدر. And بإذن الله تعالى, يعني the next darts We're going to the second half, or the hadith, which brings about the second principle for the acceptance of the acts of worship, because this hadith explains the first condition for the acts of worship, and that is they have to be sincere before Allah Ta'ala. And this is the mizan for the internal, this is the frame of reference for our internal state, that the need has to be for Allah Ta'ala. The next hadith, inshallah Ta'ala, will be the hadith which deals with the external frame of reference, which is also the second condition for the acceptance of actions, and that is that they're done in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and that is, of course, none other than the hadith of our mother, Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala anha, that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدٌّ وَفِي الرِّوَايَةِ لِلْمُسْلِمِ مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمِلَ لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. That whoever introduces into this affair about that which is not from it, that is rejected, and whoever acts upon something that our command is not on it, that it is to reject it. Inshallah, inshallah, this will be the next verse, inshallah. فَنَكْتَفِي يَعْنِي بِهَذَا الْقَدْرُ وصلى الله عليه وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن هدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر أمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، we took the first hadith that we wanted to discuss, which was إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِلدُّنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ امْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. حديث متفق عليه من حديث عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه. The first hadith that we discussed yesterday was the hadith that verily the correctness and soundness of actions or lack thereof will be dependent upon their intentions, and that everyone will be rewarded or not rewarded based upon his or her intentions. So whoever made the migration to Allah and His Messenger, meaning intending purely migrating for the sake of Allah Ta'ala, then his reward, inshallah Ta'ala, will be that he will be rewarded for making his hijrah to Allah and His Messenger. And whoever made the hijrah, and he intended by way of it to get some worldly gain, or for some woman to take in marriage, then he will be rewarded for that which he made hijrah to. And the hadith has been collected by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, hadith al-Muttafaq alayhi, from the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And we explain that this hadith illustrates a condition from the two conditions for the acceptance of one's deeds. And when a Muslim speaks about his getting his deeds accepted, then of course this is something which is tremendous and something which is of extreme importance to each and every one of us. Because there's not a single one of us who does an action of righteousness except that he or she would like that it is accepted by Allah Ta'ala, and that they are rewarded for it. And no one wants to do any righteousness and find that it not be accepted, to find that he just wasted his time and tired himself out to no avail and for no benefit. So with that being the case, then it is incumbent and of extreme importance that we understand what are the conditions by way of which the deeds are accepted. And the first of those conditions is the niyyah, is that niyyah, it must be sincerely for Allah Ta'ala. نعم that the niyya it must be sincerely and purely for Allah Ta'ala and that an individual he be rewarded for that deed if it is for Allah Ta'ala and that deed will be accepted by Allah Ta'ala if that deed is for Allah Ta'ala and only for Allah Ta'ala and this is the first condition that one he must have al-ikhlas that one he must have al-ikhlas he must be sincere and do his deed sincerely for Allah Ta'ala and this brings us to the second hadith that was mentioned by Imam Ahmad rahimahullah Ta'ala where he said that Islam it revolves around three hadith and he mentioned from them the hadith of إنما الأعمال بالنيات and then this next hadith which we want to get into today inshallah and this hadith عن أم المؤمنين أم عبد الله عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد حديث متفق عليه وفي رواية للمسلم من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد that on the authority of the mother of the believers أم عبد الله عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها she said that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم he said whoever introduces whoever innovates in this affair of ours that which is not from it then it will be rejected that whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it then it will be rejected. And in a narration, which is only collected by Muslim, because this hadith is collected, read upon by Bukhari Muslim. But in another narration of the same hadith, which has only been collected by Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever does an action that does not have on it our command, that it will be rejected. And inshallah ta'ala will come to see the wisdom. Why Imam al-Nawawi Rahimahullah Ta'ala, he mentioned both of these ahadith, that he mentioned both narrations. There's a tremendous benefit and a great wisdom in why in which he did that. Ala kulli hal, Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, Habibullah Ta'ala, he begins his explanation about this hadith and he says, Qala, an al-mu'minin, Abdullah, Aisha, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He says, وهي أم عبد الله وهي أم المؤمنين. He says that our mother Aisha, that she was, or she had the kunya of the mother of Abdullah, أم عبد الله. And she was the mother of the believers, the daughter of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, رضي الله تعالى عنه. نعم. But this is, and he's speaking about the fact of her kunya, being Abdullah. He's saying because وَهِيَ لَيْسَ لَهَا أَوْلَاد but she did not have any children. She did not have any children of her own. Now, but yet she took the kunya of Abdullah. And in this is a proof of the legitimacy of an individual who does not have children still taking a kunya. And this is perfectly fine. He goes on, the Shaykh goes on and he says, لَكَانَا كُنِّيَةُ بِأُمْ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ He said that she was, had the kunya of عَبْدِ اللَّهِ Ma'am, does anyone know who Abdullah was? Huh? Ma'am. Did everyone hear the brother? Inshallah ta'ala, the Shaykh is Islam. Ahsan. Abdullah, as the Shaykh he says, this was her nephew. She was the aunt of Abdullah. And that was Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Now, Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So therefore she took the kunya by her nephew's name. Now, and he said, لِأَنَّ خَالَ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الْأُمْ And this is because the maternal aunt, she's in the same station, or has the same status of the mother. that maternal aunt, that she is treated like a mother. Now, so because her sister had a child, Abdullah, then she took her nephew's name as a kunya. And this is more befitting. Now, this is more befitting. And she took her nephew's name as a kunya. So she was known as Abdullah. And Abdullah was Abdullah ibn Zubayr, her nephew. رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين. The Shaykh goes on and he says, وقال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says, and whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it, then it is rejected. Then it is rejected. And the Shaykh, he says, what's intended by من أحدث في أمرنا, whoever introduces into this affair of ours, أمرنا أي في شرعنا, inside of this legislation, inside of what? Al-Islam. نعم. So whoever introduces into Al-Islam. طيب. فما معنى أحدث. So then what is the meaning of أحدث? That something is introduced. What is intended and meant by that? The Shaykh, he says, يعني أوجد عبادة لم يكن لها دليل من الكتاب من كتاب الله ولا من سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم. So what's intended by أحدث? What is being invented? Meaning that someone introduces, he invents, he makes up an act of worship, عبادة. لم يكن لها دليل, that there is no proof for it. There is no proof for it. Not in the Book of Allah, nor in the Sunnah of His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. نعم. لأن العبادات توقيفية. And this is because the acts of worship there was called توقيفية. And توقيفية emanates from the word وقفة, a وقف. نعم. That it means, يعني وقفة means to stop. It means to stop. So when it comes to the acts of worship, we say that they're توقيفية, meaning that we stop until we know the ruling of Allah and of His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then we act. Because the statement of the believers is what? سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We hear, we obey. Now, it's not the opposite. It's not we start doing stuff, and then we look for dalil. La, it's not the way of Ahlul Sunnah. The way of Ahlul Sunnah is that we see the dalil, and then we act. Because عِلْ قَبْلُ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ. Because knowledge precedes statement and action. So we know the dalil, we know the ilm, and then we act. Because we act upon that which was legislated by Allah Ta'ala and by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Sunnah. And then we act. But the way of Ahlul Bid'ah is that they take a belief and then they search around for something which they can call a dalil. Now, Ahlul Bid'ah, they take a belief and then they look for ayat or for a hadith which are general in which they try to misconstrue the meaning thereof. Now, they try to misconstrue the meaning thereof. But Allah Ta'ala has protected His religion by way of His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and by way of the Sahaba and those ulama who follow them in good, who repel the lies and these false things which are attributed to the deen of Al-Islam, Ahlul Bid'ah. Because us in the Bid'ah, it has what? It has no dalil. Because it's something which is introduced. And that thing which is introduced into this deen, then it is thus rejected. It is thus rejected. Na'am? As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said. And this is because the Shaykh goes back, he says, because ibadah is totally fear. So when it comes to worship, what? We stop. We just don't go and do things. When it comes to our methodology, نعم, we just don't go and adopt and start making up things and then try to find a deal. So for example, when it comes to the methodology of giving da'wah, how does one give da'wah to Allah? How does one call the people to Allah? Whether those people are non-believers and you want to teach them about the deen of Al-Islam, or whether those people are Muslims who don't know much about the deen of Al-Islam. Where do we begin? Where do we start? Now, all of this, because calling in da'wah is what? It's from ibadah. Correct? So we know that there is a proper Islamic methodology for calling to Allah Ta'ala. And the proof of that is found in the Book of Allah and in the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we find that the way of the Salaf was in complete correspondence to that which is found in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, so as an example, when we call to Allah Ta'ala, there is a specific thing in which we start with. And we start with that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all of the Prophets and Messengers began with. And that is with At-Tawheed. That is with At-Tawheed. And we call them upon the prophetic methodology. We don't call them upon innovative ways or invented ways. But we call them upon the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So ala sabili mithal, as an example, we don't find anything in the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he will send people out to go and teach who didn't know anything, who had no ilm. So we find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to send some of his sahaba out to teach people. From them, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Ali, he was from the ulama of the sahaba. He was from the most knowledgeable of the sahaba. He was from the scholars of the sahaba. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent him out to teach the people. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent out Mu'ad ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was also from the ulama of the sahaba. He was from the scholars of the sahaba. And he sent them out to teach. And we find that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not send them out for a specific number of days. So he did not send them out and say, you're going to go teach for 40 days and then come back. Yeah. But he sent them out, those who had ilm, to go and teach the people for a time that was not specific. So if you examine this, and you examine this methodology, that we find the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be upon his sahaba, then we see that it is in total contradiction to that which is called to by the Jama'at al-Tabligh. The first contradiction, or the first way in which the da'wah of the Tabligh contradicts the Kitab and the Sunnah, and in opposition to the Kitab and the Sunnah, is firstly, they send out individuals who themselves have no ilm. They send out individuals who themselves have no ilm. وَالْفَاقِقُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْتِيهِ The one who is deprived of something can't give it. For now, example, if you say, Akhi, can I have some water? I have a bottle of water here. I can give you some, right? Wait, I have no water here. You say, Akhi, can I have some water? I don't have water myself. So I'm going to give you water. You thirsty? I'm thirsty. I can't help you. Allah was ta'ala. Na'am? طيب واحد جاهل ما عنده علم a person who's ignorant, he has no knowledge, what are you going to call to? What is he going to teach? How can he teach the Book of Allah when he don't know the Book of Allah? How can he teach the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He don't know the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How's he going to teach the way of the Salaf, the methodology of the Salaf, and he does not know the methodology of the Salaf? And if he's ignorant of the Book of Allah, and he's ignorant of the Sunnah of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's ignorant of the way of the Salaf, what Islam is he calling to? Is there a different Islam that has nothing to do with the Book of Allah, the Sunnah, and the way of the Salaf? Is there another Islam that we don't know about? So what Islam is he calling to if he doesn't know nothing about the Book of Allah, and the Sunnah of his Messenger, and the way of the Salaf? This is the first way. And then it's stipulated upon them the second way in which they contradict the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is that they make specific number of days, 40 days, you're going to go out on Jawla. Who from the Sahaba went out for Jawla 40 days? Specific number of days. 40 days and they came back. Who did that from the Sahaba? No one. Did the Prophet ﷺ do that? No. Sahaba do that? No. وكان في خير فسبقونا إليه. If this thing was any good, they would have beaten us in doing it. So this contradicts the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So how can such a thing, which is in total contradiction to the way of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, bring about any good? Now, and we know, and this is just an example now, this is an example, that the methodology and matter of going about giving da'wah, it doesn't bring about any good. In fact, from their start to now, they have corrupted and polluted and made the Muslims worse, as the ulama have explained. Because they go to people who don't really practice Islam, they're Muslim, alhamdulillah, but they don't really practice Islam, they're sinners. They have ma'asiyah. Now, they go to these people and they indoctrinate them into their organization, into their group. And we know that their organization and their group, they are filled with those who are avid worshippers of those who are dead in the graves. And the proof of that is that their main masjid in India has multiple graves in there. Now, this is what they say is their headquarters. The headquarters, the masjid, the headquarters has multiple graves in there. So they take the people from sin to shirk and bid'ah. And which is worse, sin or bid'ah? Bid'ah. Bid'ah is worse. Bid'ah is more beloved than the shaytan. And this is because of sin, a person will make tawbah from it. The sin, yani you have minha, al-ma'asiyah. A person, he'll make tawbah from the sin. Because the one who's drinking khamr, for example, he knows drinking khamr is a sin. It's wrong. He's going to feel bad. Although he's alcoholic, although he's drinking, he knows it's wrong. A person smoking marijuana, he knows it's wrong. And if a person knows it's wrong, he knows it's a sin, then, inshallah ta'ala, he'll make what? Tawbah from it. Okay? Inshallah, he'll make tawbah from it. But the individuals who do the bid'ah, and this is why the bid'ah is more beloved to shaytan than the sin, the one who does the bid'ah, he thinks the bid'ah is good. He thinks the bid'ah is from Islam. He thinks the bid'ah will get him closer to Allah ta'ala. So, is it conceivable that a person will make tawbah from something that he thinks get him close to Allah? No, he wouldn't. Does it ever strike your mind you have to make tawbah for praying dhuhr? No. Does it strike your mind you have to make tawbah for fasting Ramadan? No. Because these are acts of worship which get you close to Allah. So because they are deluded and have been deceived by the shaytan into thinking that these acts of bid'ah are things that will get them closer to Allah, this is that of which they're not going to make tawbah from. This is that which they're going to spend a lot of time in, a lot of effort and energy in, exhausting themselves in doing these things. And we know we have been given a specific lifespan, which none of us knows, Allahu A'lam. Maybe 18 years, maybe 80 years, maybe 34 years, maybe 35 years, 32, 50, 60, Allahu A'lam. The time that we have been given. But the point is, we're not going to be here forever, and we have been given a specific amount of time, that when that time comes and death comes, that's it. There's no whole of time, let me get some, no, it's it, it's over. So knowing that you're individuals who have been given a specific portion of time as your lifespan, you don't have time to waste. You don't have time to engage in fruitless activities. So to engage and to exhaust yourselves in bid'ah, day in and day out, year in and year out, and then you die, just to realize that all of those things you did which was in opposition to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not going to count, is not going to avail you, is not going to benefit you. Yawm al-Qiyamah is not going to go on your scale of good deeds, Yawm al-Qiyamah, but if anything is going to go on your scale of evil deeds, Yawm al-Qiyamah, then you will find this is something which is extremely despicable, something which is extremely dangerous, something that will no doubt destroy you. It will not help you obtain your objective. Your objective as a Muslim, as a mu'min, is to what? Is to worship Allah Ta'ala alone upon the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hopes of what? of gaining the pleasure of Allah Ta'ala and His mercy and entering into Jannah and escaping the hellfire. This is your mission. This is your mission. What's your mission? You're trying to gain the pleasure and mercy of Allah Ta'ala so you can go to Jannah. That's your life mission. So anything that will get in the way of that and will hamper that and will impede that and be a hindrance in way of that is that which you have to avoid at all costs. Is that what you have to be serious about in avoiding it at all costs? Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَنْ لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. Whoever introduces into the prayer of ours that was not from it, then it is rejected. And this is because worship is tawqifiyya. We know first the command of Allah Ta'ala, and then we do. So the Shaykh, he says, وَمَنْ تَقَرَّبَ إِلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يُشَرِّحُهُ فَهُوَ مُتَّبِعٌ. He says, so whoever tries to get close to Allah Ta'ala with something which was not legislated, something which Allah did not legislate it, then this person is an innovator. He's an innovator. Naam. وَعَمَلُهُ مَرْدُودٌ. That his action will be rejected. It won't count. It'll be rejected. It'll be of no avail to him, no benefit. لَا يُقْبَلُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. It will not be accepted with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh says, and it's because the ibadah, it has two conditions. The first, al-ikhlasu lillahi azza wa jal. The first condition is that it has to be sincerely for Allah azza wa jal. The second condition, it has to be in accordance to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-mutaba'atu al-rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have to follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the proof of that is this hadith. The proof of the first condition is the hadith that very actions are by their intentions. The Shaykh says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ إِنسَانَ جَاءَ بِعِبَادَاتٍ مُحْدِثَةٍ لَيْسَ فِيهَا شِرْكٌ أَبَدًا كُلُّهَا خَالِصَةٌ لِلَّهِ عَزُّ وَجَالٍ وَلَكِنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ مِنْ شَرِيعَةِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم فَهِيَ بِدْعَةٌ مَرْدُودٌ لَا تُقْبَلْ. The Shaykh says, so even if a person does an action, which is an innovative action, does a bid'ah, but even in doing that bid'ah, he doesn't make shirk, period, never. He does it sincerely for Allah Ta'ala. He does it from ikhlas, lillahi ta'ala. He does it sincerely for Allah, right? But it's a bid'ah. The Shaykh says, but it's not from the sharia of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so thus it is a bid'ah, and thus it is rejected and will not be accepted. So even if he did it sincerely for Allah, if it doesn't comply with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it is still rejected. It is still rejected. It still will not count. It still will not be accepted. So then a person now may say, well, I didn't invent it. You see? They say because the hadith that مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا. Whoever invents, who innovates in this affair of ours. But I didn't invent it. I didn't make it up. Somebody else made it up. I'm just doing it. Right? So this is not on me. I didn't make it up. I'm just acting upon it. The Shaykh, he says, that you see in the second narration, which Imam al-Nawawi he brought, that من عملا عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Because we know that anything that is done contrary to the sunnah, then it is what? It is mardood. It will not be accepted. And in the next narration, we see that the one who does it, then it's still rejected. Now, the Shaykh, he says, وفي الرواية الثانية من عمل عملا. That whoever does an action. He says, so in this riwayah, we find that whoever does the reaction is still not accepted. Now, He says, so if it is said that verily I didn't do this, but rather I'm just following, now someone comes and he says, أَلَمْ أُحْدِثْ شَيْئًا, I didn't introduce anything, إِلَّمَا أَنَا أَعْمَلُ بِمَا عَمِلَ بِهِ مَا قَبْلِ. He said, I didn't introduce anything, I'm just doing or following something with someone before me, innovated. The shaykh, he says, نَقُولُ لَهُ. So that's what we'll say to this one. حَتَّى إِنْ أَحْدَثَهُ وَعَمِلَ بِهِ مَنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ فَمَا دَامَ بِالْعَسِنْ فَلَا يَجُوزُ لَكَ أَنْ تَعْمَلِهِ. He says, so we say that even if it was introduced and acted upon by those who came before you, still, as long as it is a bid'ah, it is not permissible for you to follow them. فَإِنْ قَالَ, and even if this one says, إِنَّمَا تَبْعُ الْمَسْؤُولِيَّةِ عَلَى مَنْ ابْتَدَعَهَا. He said, but no, no. The only one who's at fault here, or the only one who's responsible here is going to be questioned, is what? The one who invented it. Then we say to him, المسؤولية, the responsibility here is upon the one who invented it and upon the one who worked upon it. So it's not just upon the inventor of it. It's upon the inventor of the innovation and the one who followed him in that innovation. And he said, and what's our dalil for this? Our dalil for this is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمِلَ لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. That whoever does an action that does not have it on our command, it is rejected. That whoever does an action that does not have it on our command, it is rejected. So we benefit from the two narrations. Whoever introduces something, and whoever acts upon something. So it does not stipulate it that you have to be the introducer of a thing in order for it to be rejected. Now, if you act upon that which was introduced by other than you, then it is still rejected. It is still rejected. Now, and the shaykh, he says that قوله فهو رد, that it is rejected, أي مردود عليه لا يقبل عند الله سبحانه وتعالى, is rejected, meaning that it will be rejected upon that individual and not accepted by Allah Ta'ala. The shaykh, he says, مَحْمَا أَتْعَبَ الْإِنسَانُ نَفْسَهُ فِيهِ. No matter how much a person exhausts himself in doing that deed, it still will not be accepted. So it's not a condition that, okay, but if I work really hard, then still, no, it still will not count. And also, no matter how pure the intention is, if it's in contradiction to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it still will not count. So thus, it is not looked upon. The shaykh, he says, فَلَا يُنْظَرُ إِلَّا صُلَاحَةِ النِّيَّةِ وَحُسْنُ الْقَصْدِ. So it's not looked to the pureness of your niyyah and your good intention only. The shaykh, he says, بَلَّا بُدْ للمتابعة حتى يقبل العمل. But rather, it also must be in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, so that action can be accepted. فإن خلا من أحد هذين الشرطين فهو مردود على صاحبه. So if it is missing one of these two conditions, then it will be rejected upon his companion or the one who does it. So a person does something, it is upon the sunnah, but he does not have ikhlas, is not sincere for Allah, it is not accepted. If a person does something and it is sincere for Allah, but it's not upon the sunnah, then it is rejected as well. So thus, the only way, the only option, is that he must do it sincerely for Allah and in accordance with the sunnah of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for that's the only way it will be accepted. And the shaykh, he says, فَفِيهِ أَوْ ففي هذا دليل على بطلان البدعة جميعها. And in this there is a clear proof which points to the erroneousness of all bid'ah. It points to the erroneousness of all bid'ah. نعم بطلان البدعة. All bid'ah. The shaykh says, وَأَنَّ صَاحِبَهَا آثم غير مأجور. It points to the erroneousness of all bid'ah and also to the fact that the one who does the bid'ah, he is a sinner. He's a sinner and he won't be rewarded. And the Shaykh says, لِأَنَّ مُحْدِثٌ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى because this action that he's doing, it is an innovation in Allah Ta'ala's deen and that which is not from it. وَمَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ نعم وَفِيهِ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى أَنَّ بِدْعَةٌ فِي الدِّينِ كُلُّهَا مَرْدُودَ And it's also a proof that all bid'ah, irregardless of its scale or its type, then it will all be rejected. فَفِيهِ رَدٌ عَلَى مَنْ يَقُولُ إِنَّ هُنَاكَ بِدْعَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ He says, so thus it is a reputation of those who say that there is such a thing as a bid'ah that is hasana. There is such a thing as a good bid'ah. Because you have those who say that the bid'ah is of two types, bid'ah that's good and bid'ah that's bad. And this is incorrect. What is correct is that all bid'ah is bad. And the proof of that is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which we hear all the time, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ that verily every innovative matter is a bid'ah. وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ And every bid'ah is a going astray. وَفِ الرِّوَايَةِ وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ And every going astray is in the hellfire. So this narration from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, it refused those to say this is such thing as a good bid'ah. Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, فَإِنَّ كُلَّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ وَكُلَّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ كُلْ Every. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, مُعْظِمُ الْبِدْعَةِ لا, every. Not most, the majority of, no, every bid'ah. Every bid'ah is a going astray, every going astray is an hellfire. The Shaykh says, وَهَذَا يَقُولُ هُنَاكَ بِدْعَةٍ حَسَنَةٍ We have the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم which informs us that every bid'ah is a going astray, every going astray is in the fire, and this one's going to say, but no, it's a bid'ah حَسَنَةٍ لا. The Shaykh says, وَهَذَا مُخَالِفٌ لِقَوْلِهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم He said, this one, he is in opposition to the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that what? Kul bid'atin dhalal. Every bid'ah is a dhalal. The Shaykh, he says, even, فَلَيْسَ هُنَاكَ بِدْعَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ Therefore, there is no bid'ah that hasana. إِنَّمَا بِدْعَةٌ يعني كُلُّهَا سَيِّئَةٌ مَرْدُودَةٌ بِنَصِ الْحَدِيثِ He says, so thus, every bid'ah is evil, every bid'ah is rejected, And the proof is the textual proof that's contained in this hadith. نعم. لكن هؤلاء يحاولون إجادة البدع وتحسينها. He said, but these individuals, they still don't stop. They still strive hard to convince the people of the possibility of bid'ah and that it's really something that's good. فيقولون and they say عن البدع عن بدعة الاحتفال بمولد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم These individuals, they say, when it comes to the bid'ah of celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they say, إِنَّهَا بِدْعَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ They say, the celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a good bid'ah. لِأَنَّهَا دَلِيلٌ عَلَى حُبِّ الرَّسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ They say, because when we practice his birthday and celebrate his birthday, then this is the indication and it points to the fact that we love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. SubhanAllah, the implications of this statement. The Shaykh, he says, فَعَلَى قُولِهِمْ هَذَا يَكُونُ أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرٍ وَعُثْمَانٍ وَعَلِيٍ وَكَابِرٍ الصَّحَابَ لَا يُحِبُّونَ رَسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ What's implied by this statement that we're doing this because we love the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said then, upon this statement of theirs, then this means that Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali wa akabiru al-Sahaba and the big Sahaba. Rather, all of the Sahaba didn't love the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم because they never practiced his birthday. None of them ever practiced his birthday. So you can't say we celebrate his birthday out of love. Because his companions loved him more than any of us. So if you do it out of love, you say they didn't love him because they didn't practice it. Now, they never practice it. The Prophet ﷺ himself never practiced it. So what are you saying? The Shaykh says, فَلَيْسَ إِحْدَاثُ الْبِدْعَةِ دَلِيلًا عَلَى مُحَبَّةِ الرَّسُولِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He says, so the innovating and innovating bid'ah and innovative matters, this does not point to that a person loved the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, بَلْ ذَلِكَ دَلِيلٌ عَلَى بُغْضِهِ. He said, but rather this is a clear indication of his hatred for the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he says, مَنْ كَانَ يُحِبُّ الرَّسُولِ صلى الله عليه وسلم, whoever truly loves the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, فَإِنَّهُ يَتَّبِعُ. Whoever truly loves the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he's going to follow him. Why? Because you imitate those you love. Correct? You follow and listen to and obey those you love. The Shaykh, he said, la, you khalifu. You don't go against the one you love. The person doesn't disrespect the one he loves. Try to be completely different from the one he loves. Try to be completely opposite from the one he loves. La. And the Shaykh, he said, just like the poet said, لو كان حبك صادقا لأطعت إِنَّ مُحَبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. He said, this is because if your love is truthful, then you would have obeyed him. إِنَّ مُحَبَّ لِمَنْ يُحِبُّ مُطِيعُ. Because the one who truly loves his loved one, he obeys him. He follows him. Yeah? So if you truly love the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he will what? You will obey him. You will be upon his sunnah. You will be compliant to his sunnah. You will not be in opposition to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So their statement that we're doing this bid'ah hasanah because out of love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then we tell them, Rabbi, you're lying, you don't love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and furthermore, you don't love Allah ta'ala. And what's the proof of that? Is that Allah ta'ala says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah Ta'ala says, say to them, O Muhammad, if you truly love Allah, if you're truthful in your statement that you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُوا, then follow me. Meaning follow Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and Allah will love you. So when a person acts in opposition to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then this is an indication that one, he does not love Allah. Because this verse is a test. If you're truthful in your claim that you love Allah, you have to follow Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. So if you don't follow Muhammad, then this shows that what? You don't really love Allah. You're not truthful when you say you love Allah. Now, when you're not truthful when you say you love Allah. And it also points to the fact that what? That Allah Ta'ala does not love you. Because if you love Allah and you follow the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah Ta'ala says, then what? Then Allah will love you. Then Allah will love you. And it's also an indication that you're also not truthful when you say you love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if you love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you would follow him. So do you see the danger of the bid'ah? When a person takes away other than the way of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he is saying that what? He does not love Allah. He does not love the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is what his actions are saying. That he really does not love Allah nor the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Because if one truly loved Allah Ta'ala, then he would obey and be upon that which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was upon. Because Allah Ta'ala sent the Messenger of Allah to explain to us our religion. So if you truly love Allah Ta'ala, then you will love and obey and follow the one who He sent to you to teach you your religion. If you truly love Allah Ta'ala, then you won't belie Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala said, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمْ إِسْلَامَ دِينَ. Allah Ta'ala says, on this day I have perfected for you your religion and completed. You see the words, completed upon you my favor, and I'm pleased for you. Islam is a religion. The deen is perfect. It is complete. That which is perfect and complete does not need any addition. Correct? So if you bring something which is not found in the Book of Allah, and is not found in the Sunnah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because the source of Islam is what? The Book of Allah and the Sunnah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we find something that is not contained in the Book of Allah, nor in the Sunnah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then it is something which is not from Islam. If something is not from Islam, and if it's not from Islam, and you're trying to add it, you're trying to add it as an addition, you're trying to bring it into the deen, you're saying that the deen is deficient and thus needs it, you're saying that you belied the verse when Allah Ta'ala said that He completed your favor, He completed your religion, completed the favor upon you. You're saying thus by your bid'ah that what? No, not really, the deen is not complete. This is what you're saying, you're belying Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala says the deen is complete, that which is perfect does not need anything else, does not need an addition. But while you bring it in addition, you're saying that you don't believe that in that verse. You don't believe the deen is complete. But rather you think that the deen is deficient, and thus you have to complete it with your bid'ah. So this is not something little, this is something that is great. When a person makes bid'ah, that which he is saying, whether it is implied or whether it is articulated, is something which is despicable. And this is why Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, رحمه الله تعالى. He said, من زعم أنه سيحتدي بغير هدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فعليه لعنة الله والناس والملائكة والناس أجمعين. He said that whoever foolishly thinks that he can be guided by other than the guidance of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he will have upon him the curse of Allah, the angels and all of mankind. Because of the despicableness in which he is saying. The deen is not complete, I don't believe that. I don't believe in that person. The deen ain't complete, so I have to complete it with bid'ah. The individual implying by his actions, I don't love Allah. I don't love the Messenger. The individual who by way of his actions is the proof that Allah does not love him. What kind of individual can this be except one who was cursed? So the bid'ah is something that is tremendous, it's something that is tremendously dangerous. And this is why you find from the methodology of Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah, with understanding, truly understanding, the danger of the bid'ah. For those who truly love Allah Ta'ala, and truly love His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this is why they avoid the mubtadi'ah, this is why they do not sit with the mubtadi'ah. How can you sit with an individual? Because Ahlul Sunnah, we are those who we say, La, we love Allah truly. Thus we follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because we want Allah Ta'ala to love us. We love the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we listen, obey Him. So how can you stomach and sit with an individual who his actions reek of, I don't love Allah and I don't love the Messenger. How can you sit with an individual like that? How can you stomach an individual like that? Why would you want to listen to an individual like that and claim that you're going to take the good when it comes and leave off the evil? A'udhu billah, there's nothing of good that person can ever say except that the people of the truth have already said it. So guys, we don't need to listen to anybody who has the bid'ah. We don't need to listen to go sit with anyone who has the bid'ah. There's nothing that they have that we need. Because the people of the truth have more right to the truth, and the people of the truth have with them the truth. So as the Mashaykh, they say, O Ahlul Sunnah, thus we take from the pure sources. We take from the pure sources. As Shaykh Abu Amr al-Hajuri, he said, so let be like the bee. Because the bee takes from the pure sources, that nectar, and then what comes out of the bee? Honey. Takes from the pure comes out. As opposed to an individual who says, I'd rather go to a garbage dump and try to get dinner from there. You would say, this doesn't make any sense. What do you mean you'll go to a garbage dump? So if you liken it to food, then you see how silly it really is. The person says, I'm going to go say this to the Motevi Eid, and I'm going to take the good and leave the bad. It's like a person saying, I'm really hungry right now, so I'm going to go to the garbage, I'm going to pick out the good piece of food, and I'm going to move away the garbage, the dirty peppers and all this, I'm going to move that out the way and get the apple. What sense does that make? What sense does that make? I'm hungry, I'm going to go to the dump. I'm hungry, hey, what you got in the garbage? Who says that? I'm feeling hungry, what you got in the garbage? Nobody says that. They say, I'm hungry, what you got in the fridge? Not what's in the trash can. Because that don't make sense to no one. In no one's book does that make sense. And this is with food. This is with food. So that if you eat something that's filthy with garbage, got salmonella, whatever, your body gets sick. Your stomach hurts. You get food poisoning. How is that compared to taking in falsehood and your soul gets destroyed? Taking in misguidance and you go astray. One is not compared to the other. So if you don't take it, and the only thing that's at stake is a bellyache, how in the world are you going to take it when your soul is at stake? If it don't make sense, and the worst going to happen to you is you're going to have the runs, how in the world does it make sense, and the worst thing going to happen to you is you get thrown into the hellfire? If it don't make sense here, it can't make sense there. In this, ya ibad, this, ya ibad, is the reason that the methodology of Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah is the way it is. So that we may gain benefit for ourselves, and so that we may spread to the Muslims benefit. So it's nothing that from harshness, it's nothing that, there's nothing that emanates out of hatred, but rather is that which emanates out of love. That you love your brother, so you advise him, and you tell him, actually what you're doing is bid'ah, is fukh, it's not going to benefit you, rather it's going to hurt you. This is out of love. This is like if you saw your brother hungry and he's sifting through the garbage for food. The person who has hatred and scorn for him, he'll watch him do that and not say a word. He'll watch him do that and he won't grab him by his hand and say, come, let me get you something to eat. He'll watch him sift through the garbage and he'll let him eat like that. And if he's deluded enough to thinking that what he's doing is good, he's getting a good meal, then he'll let him believe that. This is the one who hates that person. This sign of hatred. That I'm going to see you eating out of garbage and let you eat out of garbage. This sign that I hate your guts, I hate you. Go ahead, eat the garbage, I don't care. This is not the sign of a brother who shows brotherly love. As Muslims, we're brothers one to another. So if you saw your brother eating from the garbage, naturally what were you going to do? You're going to take him by the hand and say, alright, I'm going to get you something to eat. If I don't have it in my house, I'm going to take him to the restaurant and make sure he gets something good to eat. So if this is going to be your attitude with food, then thus you understand the attitude when now the person is putting his soul on the line. When the person may be punished by Allah Ta'ala for what he's doing. Out of love, you're going to stop that brother with all forms of kindness and niceness. Trying every way possible to say, actually, no, you don't want to do this. No. You don't want to do this. This is where you take from here. What Allah said, what the Prophet ﷺ said, what the Sahaba were upon. This way you're going to be safe. This way you're going to be okay. That's out of love. It's out of love, ya ibad. So understand this, inshaAllah ta'ala. As the Prophet ﷺ said, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. Hadith متفق عليه. When the Prophet ﷺ he said, whoever introduces into this affair about that which is not from it, then it is going to be rejected. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من عمل ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Whoever does an action that does not have on it our order, then it is rejected. حديث رواه مسلم. حديث has been collected by Muslim. ونكتفي بهذا القدر. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اذهب في الدنيا يحبك الله. Abstain from the dunya and Allah will love you. So now it's important to understand what is abstaining. What is the concept of abstention in Islam? The Shaykh, he says, Zuhud huwa tark. That Zuhud, it means to leave off something. Zuhud. It means to leave off something. Now, yani, usrik al-dunya. Leave off the dunya. Leave off the dunya. The Shaykh, he says, walaysa al-murad an tatruka ma tahtaju ilayhi. This is very important. He said, but it's not intended that you leave off that which you need. This is not what it means. Leave off the dunya, so therefore a person leaves off that what he needs. Ma'am, this is not what that means. He says, that you cannot leave off that which you need from trying to seek out the provisions and to earn a halal money and the like. Because of course, to leave off that which you need is something which is in fact prohibited. It's not allowed for a Muslim to leave off the things of which he needs. But rather what is intended is that an individual, he leaves off those extra things from the dunya of which he has no need for. As the Shaykh says, إِنَّمَا زُهْرُ تَرْكُ الْفُضُولِ الَّذِي لَا تَحْتَاجُ إِلَيْهَا مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. That the zuhr is that you leave off those extras, things that you don't need from the dunya. So for example, if an individual is in need of a vehicle to transport himself back and forth to his place of work, if he has a vehicle and it's good and it runs well and the like, and then his family, his wife has a vehicle so she can transport the kids back and forth to school and the like, then is there any need for him trying to seek out a third vehicle? There's no need for him. He has no need for it. Both cars are good, good shape, good condition. They work fine. So there's no need for him to be wanting a third that's just going to sit in the driveway anyway. Now, this is an example. So the Shaykh, he says, يعني في المسلم يعني يجمع في طلبه يجمع يعني في طلبه so that the Muslim, يعني he beautifies that which he's seeking after. لا يحرص يعني حرصا شديدا على الدنيا وعنده ما يغنيه. He's not going to look and strive after tenaciously aspects of the dunya of which he is in no need of anyway. Huh? And how many people run themselves to ruin because of that? Running after and seeking after things of which they don't need anyway. And they run themselves to ruin, run themselves ragged, chasing after things in which they don't need anyway. And it brings nothing but misery to their lives. It brings nothing but misery to their lives. And we should understand, ya ibad, that this dunya is not something which is remaining. But as every second goes by, this dunya is leaving us. We are getting closer and closer to our death. So if an individual understands this with a good understanding, then it wouldn't make sense to chase after things of which you have no benefit for you, of which you don't need in the first place that are not going to benefit you. As one of the poets, he said, تَرْجُ الْبَقَى بِدَارٍ لَا بَقَاءٌ لَهَا هَلْ سَمِعْتَ بِظِلٍ غَيْرُ مُنْتَقِلٍ. He said that, are you looking after, or do you want and desire to stay in a place in which, in a situation in which is not to remain anyway? Are you seeking to stay and remain in a place which is not going to remain, which is not meant to remain anyway? He said, and have you ever heard of a shade that stays stationary? Because this is the nature of the dunya. The shade doesn't stay in one spot. Depending on the position of the sun, the shade will move, correct? The shadows will grow longer and shorter and move from here to there. Because what? The sun is moving. There's nothing in this dunya that's supposed to remain. Nothing in this dunya is supposed to remain. When an individual eats or drinks that which he really enjoys, how long does that flavor remain in his mouth? But some seconds. And this is the reality of the life of this world. So therefore, one of the poets he used to say, لَا تَغْبَطَنَّ أَخِ الدُّنْيَا لِزُخْرُوفِهَا وَلَا لَذَّةٍ وَقْتٍ عَجَلَتْ فَفَرِحَا فالدهر أسرع شيء في تقلبه وفعله فين لخلق قد وضحا كم شارب عسلا فيه منيته وكم تقلد سيفا من كان به ذبحا. سبحان الله. He said, do not be deceived, do not want, do not seek after the life of this dunya, or do not seek after, O person of the dunya, O brother of the dunya. Do not seek after this dunya because of its adornments, because of its luxuries. and not for the sweetness that one may gain from some time which has been given. So thus he becomes happy. Some little bit of time he has been given in this dunya. Don't seek after that. Because as we said, the dunya is not meant to last. And your time here is even shorter than its time. Now, so this little short piece of time that you've been given, whatever you tasted from sweetness, don't let that delude you. And then he points to the reality. He said, فَالدَّهْرُ أَسْرَعُ شَيْءٍ فَتُقَلُّبِهِ. That the time, meaning that the situations in this life for the one who chases after the dunya, that it is the quickest thing which will turn on you. The quickest thing. An individual chases after the dunya, that all he's concerned about is the dunya, the dunya, the dunya. The quickest thing to cause his destruction is what? The dunya. He's chasing after the life of this world. That's all he's worried about. The life of this world, the life of this world, the life of this world. And that which ends up destroying him is what? He's chasing after the life of this world. And we see this all the time. How many millionaires commit suicide because they made one bad move on the stock market and lost millions? Kills himself. Chasing after the dunya. And he says, وَفِعْلُ بَيِّنُ لِلْخَلْقِ قَدْ وَضَحَ. That, yani the actions that takes place and turning on the individual is clear, well known. It's well known to all of the creation. And then he brings an example. He says, how many people who are obsessed with honey find therein is their death? How many people who are honey connoisseurs have to have the most strangest type of honey and the like, end up dying from some bacteria that was contained in some honey they got from the rainforest somewhere? This is what he means. Now, but we can draw examples from this. How many people are so obsessed with things who end up being their death? Obsessed with cars and this and that and that and that and that, and he dies on the freeway in a car crash because he missed the turn going too fast. And then he brings another example. He says, how many people who used to carry around the sword are thus killed by the sword in which they used to slaughter with? This is the reality of this life, is that it is something that is not meant to last. So therefore the Muslim, he has to understand exactly how he should treat this life. He should understand exactly how he should treat this life. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, when explaining Zuhd, he said, Zuhd huwa tarku ma la yanfa' fil akhirah. Allahu Akbar, this is very important. He says that Zuhd, being abstentious and leaving off the world, right? He said, is to leave off that which will not benefit you in the next life. فَمَنْ كَانَ قَلْبُهُ أَوْ فَمَنْ كَانَ بِقَلْبِهِ رَغْبَةً فِي الْآخِرَةِ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَعْمَلْ بِالْعَمَلٍ إِلَّا إِذَا كَانَ نَافِعًا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. He says, so whoever his heart is connected to the hereafter, then he will not work with the action except that it will benefit him in the hereafter. وَإِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ نَافِعًا لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ فَإِنَّهُ يَتْرُكُهُ. And if it's something that will not benefit you in the akhirah, then you leave it off. This will be your frame of reference. You want to have zuhud, you want to abstain from this life, then this is what you think about. When things are presented to you, question yourself, will this benefit me in the next life? If the answer is yes, do it. If the answer turns out to be no, then don't do it. Stay away from it. And this brings us to another hadith, which are from those hadith which Islam revolves around. And that's the hadith, من حسن الإسلام المرء تركه ما لا يعنيه. That from a person's good Islam is that he leaves off that which does not concern him. The ulama, they explain, أن المعنى لا يعنيه أي لا ينفعه. That the meaning of that which does not concern him, it means that which will not benefit him. That from a person's good Islam is that he leaves off that which does not benefit him. And then the opposite as well. Because from a person's good Islam is that he leaves off that which does not benefit him, and also from his good Islam is that he takes to that which benefits him. You see? He takes to that which benefits him. And this is the reality, and this is how those who are intelligent treat this dunya. Imam al-Nawawi, he brings in his introduction to Riyad al-Salihin some lines of poetry which are beautiful. He says, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ عِبَادًا فُطُونَا طَلَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَخَافُوا الْفِتْنَا نَظَرُوا فِيهَا فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِحَيٍّ وَطَنَا جَعْلُوهَا لُجَّةٍ وَاتَّخَذُوا صَالِحُ الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا سُفُنَا. He says that Allah has very intelligent servants. They have divorced the dunya. They have divorced this world and they fear its calamities. طَلَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا They have divorced it. And they fear its calamities. They deeply looked with regards to it. They deeply researched this matter. نَظَرُوا فِيهَا They deeply researched and looked and examined to the dunya. فَلَمَّا عَلِمُوا And once they have done that, they have come to know أَنَّهَا لَيْسَتْ لِحَيٍ وَطَنَا That this is not a place for those who are truly alive. This is not an abode for those who are truly alive. Those who truly understand. This is not a place of residence for them. So thus realizing that this dunya is not a place of residence for them, جَعْلُوهَا لُجَّةً So therefore they look upon the dunya as if it is just a vast ocean. That's all it is. This dunya is a vast ocean. In order to get to the akhirah, you have to go through the dunya. And because they want their final destination in the akhirah to be Jannah, فَاتَّخِذُوا صَالِحَ الْأَعْمَالِ فِيهَا سُفُنَا So therefore they want their final destination to be the Jannah, so thus they have taken their righteous actions as their boat. So they utilize this dunya for what? To attain righteousness. They utilize the time in which Allah Ta'ala has given them inside of this dunya to properly believe in Allah Ta'ala, to work righteous deeds, and to strive hard. Because that's the only benefit that this dunya can possibly offer anyone. Another poet he said, commenting on this concept, لَدَارُ لِلْمَرْءِ بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ يَسْكُنُهَا إِلَّا الَّتِي كَانَ قَبْلَ الْمَوْتِ بنيها فإن بناها بخير طاب مسكنه وإن بناها بشر خاب بانيها He said that an individual he will not have any place to reside in after death except for that one he built for himself before death so if he built it with good then his place of residence after death will be good. And if he built it with evil, then his place of residence would have been corrupt and thus evil and despicable. So we must take our opportunity in this dunya to seek after that which will benefit us in the akhirah. And this is the meaning of having zuhud inside of the dunya. And if an individual were blessed to accomplish this, then Allah Ta'ala will love him. And then, which reinforces this concept, is the fact that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he directed this individual to leave off what the people had. A case of an individual still thinks that no zuhd means that I leave off everything. I walk around in the same thaw for the rest of my life, irregardless of how many strings are still holding it together or not. I leave off working. I leave off trying to gain halal wages. And I take the begging, getting what I can get when I can get it. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, makes it clear that this is not the meaning of zuhud. Because you have a lot of people and they'll come and they're the most raggedy looking thing ever and they'll say, but I'm a zahid. Being a zahid don't mean you have to look raggedy. Being a zahid doesn't mean you have to be poor. You can be a zahid and be rich. You can be one who abstains from the dunya and you're rich. One may say, well, how is that possible? Because the ulama, they explain that the one who really abstains from the dunya is the one who has not let the dunya in his heart. His heart is not connected to the dunya. It's not connected to the dunya. He takes the money and he spends. He's not connected to it. The money don't control him. He controls the money. So thus you can be rich and still be a zahid. Why? Because you're not concerned with it. The master needs money, he spends bismillah. This single individual needs help this month with food, he spends bismillah. No problem, no hardship for him. He's not concerned. Oh man, if I get him 100, how much I got left? He's not concerned. They need, he has, he gives. Because he's not connected to it. He's not attached to it. If he has it, alhamdulillah. If he doesn't have it, alhamdulillah. That's not his concern. His concern is what? مَا يَنْفَعُهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ. That's his concern. That which will benefit him in the next life. That's his concern. So if he got money, alhamdulillah. He utilizes it to benefit him in the next life. If he don't have money, alhamdulillah. He tells others to use their money so that they benefit. So he can get the benefit as well. Because whoever points the person to doing good, he will have the reward of the one who does the good. Does he worry about not having money? Nah. He works hard to get what he needs, and he puts his energy in other righteous deeds that he has the ability to do. You see? This is the reality of the movement. If Allah Ta'ala bless him with money, he views it as what? Another means to attain good for myself in the Akhirah. Now I can give more sadaqah. I was giving $10, now I can give 100. I'm not going to feel it. I'll give 200, 300. He looks at it as an opportunity. He doesn't put it in safes. And hires all types of armed guards to watch it for him. And covet it. And hoard it. And become miserly. Nah. He spends peace of being loved. He views it as an opportunity to gain benefit for himself. To make him a bigger boat to get across this sea of the dunya. What point to that is what? وَسَدْ بِمَا عِنْدَ النَّاسِ يُحَبُّكَ النَّاسِ. And abstain from that which the people have, and the people will love you. As Shaykh Salih Fawzan, he says, meaning, that you're not concerned, and you're not looking after, and trying to see what the people have. He says, because if you were to chase after what the people have, and then constantly ask them for things, then they're going to hate you. Now, how many people truly in their hearts love the beggars who constantly beg and beg and beg and beg? Every time you turn around, he got the gimmies. Gimme, gimme, gimme. How many people love people like that? No one. So if you want the people to love you, then refrain from asking them for what they have. The Shaykh, he says, وَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. And seek aid and assistance from Allah Ta'ala. And don't ask the people. As much as that is possible. Don't ask the people as much as that is possible. The Shaykh, he says, but if you are in need of something, then there's no problem for you to ask them because you aren't truly in need of it. So a person is in dire need of something. Or the Shaykh, he says, عند الضرورة, then it is no problem to ask because he's in truly in need of that thing. So then, therefore, ask, no problem, because he truly needs it. But as much as you possibly can, a person should try to attain stability and independence from the people, financially and otherwise. He says, strive his best so that he can become financially independent from the people. And otherwise. And if an individual was to do this, then the people will love that individual. Because if not, if you were constantly asking them for that which they have with them, constantly begging them for that which they have with them, and making a hardship on them, then as a result, they're not going to love you. As a result, they're not going to love you. The Shaykh, he goes on and he says that the poet, he says, لَا تَسْأَلَنْ بَنُ آدَمَ حَاجَةً وَسَلِ الَّذِي أَبْوَابُهُ لَا تُحْجَبُ اللَّهُ يَغْضَبُهُ إِذَا أَنْتَرَبْتَ سُؤَالَهُ وَبُنُ آدَمَ حِينَ يَسْأَلُ يَبْغُضُ أو يَبْغَضُ. He says, and do not ask the children of Adam if you need something. Of course, we know in parentheses, if you're able to, avoid asking them. He says, but rather ask the one who his door is never closed. Because Allah becomes angry if you leave off asking him, and the children of Adam, when you ask them, they get angry. And this is the reality. The children of Adam, when you ask them, they get angry. So thus we learn in this hadith a tremendous benefit. And that is, if we leave off the life of this world, Allah Ta'ala will love us. And if we leave off that which the people have, then the people will love us. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said in another hadith, كن في الدنيا كأنك غريب أو عابر السبيل. That be in this world as if you are a stranger or like a traveler just passing through. Because verily from one who is strange in a place, he's not trying to set up camp in that place. But he takes from that place what he needs so he can continue on his journey. Or like the one who is on a journey, if he's traveling and going through a place, then he takes what he needs from it so he can continue with his journey. But he doesn't become attached to it. His heart doesn't become connected to it. And likewise, this is how the mu'min is to be in this dunya. Is that we take from this dunya that which we need. And we worry about our situation in the Akhirah. So we strive to benefit ourselves with that which will benefit us in the next life. Not allowing this life to be a hindrance and to get in the way of our success in the next life. If an individual was to do this and to be blessed with these characteristics of leaving off that which is in this dunya from those things of which he does not need and not being attached to it and being having concern for benefiting himself in the next life, then Allah Ta'ala will love him. And if he leaves off asking the people and begging them and constantly beseeching them for whatever they may have with them, then the people will love them. And this is the mu'min. This is the mu'min. He has integrity. He is one who is noble. He is not one who strives to be on the lower hand, but rather he is one who strives to have the upper hand. As the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said that the upper hand is better than the lower hand, meaning that the one who is giving is better than the one who is getting. The one who gives the charity, he's better than the one who is always receiving the charity. So the Muslim, we strive to be the best. And the best in this instance is what? Is to be the one who's giving the sadaqah. Not the one who is always needing the sadaqah, but the one who is giving the sadaqah. So that means that an individual, he begs Allah Ta'ala to bless him with these things. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he taught us in a tremendous dua, which says, Allahumma a'tini huda wa tuqa wal afafa wal ghina. Oh Allah, give me huda. Imam Sa'di, he says, al-huda ay ilmu nafi'. Oh Allah, give me guidance. Imam Sa'di, he says, the meaning of guidance is beneficial knowledge. وَالتُّقَى قال إمام سعدي والمعنى تقى عمل الصالح. إمام سعدي, he says, in the meaning of piety, it means beneficial, or it means righteous actions. والعفافة, he said, the meaning of عفافة, it means that a person's heart is not connected to the dunya. A person's heart is not connected to the people and what they have with them. So this one, will be granted to be what? Independent of the people. Their heart not connected with what they have. Wal-ghina. Imam Hussein, he said that the meaning of ghina means that this person is content with what he has. He's content with what he has. And this is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us. Because like this is how the mu'min should be, the Muslim should be. One who's striving after beneficial knowledge, performing righteous deeds, not concerned or connected with what the people may have with them, and one who is content with that which Allah Ta'ala has blessed him with. Izhar fi dunya, yuhibbuk Allah, wazhar fi ma'inda al-nas, yuhibbuk al-nas. Abstain from this worldly life, and Allah will love you. Abstain from what the people have, and the people will love you. Wa نكتفي بهذا القدر لأن خير الكلام ما قل ودل فنكتفي بهذا القدر وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.